Welcome to So Jeongwook Art Talk. Today, for our fifth work, let me introduce Jacques-Louis David's Oath of the Horatii. First, let me explain the story. When the artwork was released in 1785, most people would have been familiar with its contents. This tragedy was being performed on stage in Paris at the time. So, we should get to grips with it too. On the left stand three young Roman soldiers, with a wide-legged stance, each with one arm outstretched in front of them. That gesture is an ancient Roman salute, used to show respect or when swearing an oath. In front of them, you can see three swords. They are currently swearing an oath. Can you see the tension on their faces? Their jaws clenched, trying to keep something down inside. Now look at their legs, arms, even the hand around this man's waist. In everything you can sense the tension. We can clearly see every muscle and blood vessel bulging. When standing in front of this huge painting, you can't avoid the stiffness of these figures. This painting stands 3 meters tall and 4 meters wide. This time, look at the middle-aged man in the center. With his left hand, he raises the three swords high, his right hand facing towards the sky. Let's look closer. His gaze is faced skyward. His mouth hangs open and he is mid-prayer to the gods, saying, "Today, my sons, Horatii brothers and children of Rome represent their country in battle. From the kingdom of Alba Longo, the unrivaled brothers Curatii stand against them. As they stand together in love of their country, bring victory upon them and let them live." In fact, this wasn't just a fight that could be won or lost. It was a fight to the death. They should be nervous. They should be scared. This started as a territorial dispute between the King of Rome and the King of Alba Longo. But as the war wore on, and as each side suffered losses, they settled on a compromise. Before any more damage was done, let us each choose champions and settle it this way. And so the Romans chose the Horatii brothers. They offered their lives readily for their country, in the name of patriotism. Of course, their father was also a true patriot. In the face of losing not just one, but all three of his sons, rather than stop them, he readies their swords. If you haven't guessed by now, Jacques-Louis David wanted a picture to embody patriotism. He wanted to instill his people with a sense of pride for their country. Here we have three brothers ready to give up everything without hesitation. This is the attitude we need. But the patriotism doesn't end here. Look to the right. Three women lie overcome with grief. Are they sad because their family leaves for war? Not exactly. On the left, in the green clothes, is the mother and wife to the man bearing the swords. She is sitting with her grandchildren. Is she sad? Her three sons are leaving to face death on the battlefield. Still, she looks less sad than the two women next to her. After all, if fortune favors them, they might survive. They would become heroes. But the young women think differently. For these two, death is unavoidable. On the left is Camilla. She is the sister of the Horatii, but unfortunately, she's engaged to one of the Curatii that her brothers are set to battle. Whatever happens in this battle, she's going to lose either her brothers or her betrothed. Next to her, Sabina is no different. She was married into the Horatius family, but the Curatii are her true family. Either her brothers or her husband will die in this fight. The Horatii and Curatii households are linked in such a way. But Jacques-Louis David hasn't focused on the tragedy of this situation. Put before all this, David has emphasized the love for one's country. And so, unlike the women in the picture, the men show no doubts in their actions, thanks to their patriotic spirit. But that spirit doesn't end here. It isn't depicted in this picture, but let's take a look at the next scene. This is a sketch made by Jacques-Louis David. This is the aftermath of the battle. On the right, two soldiers hold aloft two empty suits of armor. Two of the Horatii brothers have died. The one surviving brother has returned. Of course, the Curatii have been vanquished. Rome is victorious. This is a glorious reception, but Camilla bears a grudge. Her betrothed has been slain. Giving her some consolation would seem to be the right thing to do. It was for the good of Rome. It had to be this way. But the brother is furious. How could she show such a negative attitude towards her country? And if that wasn't enough, he kills her with his sword. That is Horatius with his sword drawn, and Camilla collapsed in front of him. This goes well past any normal patriotism. But again, this isn't the end. Look at the next picture. One would expect the father to scold his son for ruthlessly executing his sister. But the Horatii family are different. Stood atop the stairs, with his hand on his hips, stands the brother Horatius. Next to him, talking to a crowd, is his father. He's defending his son's actions. Rome comes before anything else, he explains, while Camilla lays dead at the foot of the stairs. This is the story of the Horatii brothers. This tale comes from Rome's founding legends. From this story, David has selected the scene of the Horatius' father offering his sons their swords and wishing upon them victory. The results of this selection were good. In Paris's 1785 Salon, visitors couldn't take their eyes off David's work. They were transfixed by the picture's intensity and its story. It was like nothing they had ever seen before. David became a symbol of the neoclassicist movement, and this picture was the starting point. There were three pictures at that same exhibition. The first was a landscape, the next a portrait of Marie Antoinette and her children, and the third a portrait of Mary Magdalene in the desert. The three are relatively easygoing paintings, no difficult subjects in them. Compared to these other three paintings, David's work is heavy and intense. The subject is a lot more serious. It was Louis XVI who commissioned this work. Does his name ring a bell? He was the king who ended up on the guillotine after the French Revolution. And his wife Marie Antoinette also met the guillotine. During Louis XVI's reign in 1782, France's economy suffered greatly. To the enraged populace, Louis wanted to remind them of the duty of patriotism. But patriotism had its limits. A few years after David's work was completed, the French Revolution broke out. The king and queen paid their price. But you remember last time I spoke of David's political ability. David proved his ability to succeed in the confusion of the revolution, just as he had in Louis XVI's France, as he would in the French Republic, and again in Napoleon's France. The Louvre is a space that preserves France's history, and so David, who has portrayed these different eras, is inextricably linked to this place. As such, the Louvre is decked out in his larger-than-life paintings. Viewing each work without any information is good, but if you know the history behind his work, it's better. From a modern perspective, David's work can seem wooden and stiff, so a little extra information can help make them seem a little more dynamic. And that's what I hope to leave you with here. I hope you have a great day. Next time, let's meet our sixth artwork in this tour.
Nice to meet you. Everyone, it's time to like, subscribe, and turn on notifications. See you next time.